Welcome to the Axiom Principle. I am your host, Dr. G. And tonight, I thought I'd bring up something interesting to me. I've been discussing it over the course of several months now, switching away from religious commentary and focusing on more socio-economic, socio-political commentary, mainly because the mainstream of it and how focused it is and some very disturbing things that's getting everybody on the side of this movement. So as I mentioned before in my blog, I was going to do a three-part segment regarding the core of social justice and what its problem is. That core, I see it as feminism at this point. There's too much in common with any of the other positions, and it seems to be, whenever I do a root analysis or a core structure of this, it seems to me that the focus, the center of it, is feminist ideology. I don't see any other like really huge distinctions between, say, Black Lives Matter, other than the focus on skin and race, or social justice in general, which seems to defend anybody that's a minority or they seem that needs to be defended, as if those people cannot defend themselves, it seems. But let's get into it. So first, I wanted to start with the same way that most feminists start, and that is to pitch you the dictionary definition of feminism. For any of those that aren't aware, and I'm pretty sure anybody that's covered this topic well enough can tell you that this has been hammered to death, so why not start with it? But there's a reason why I'm starting with it, unlike most other arguments, and I think it's because many kind of touch on where the issue is, but they miss the mark when it comes to outlining the actual problem. So here we go. The theory of the political, economic, and social equality of the sexes. That's part one. Part two is organized activity on the behalf of women's rights and interests. So feminism, in its own definition, the first part is equality of the sexes. No problem there for anybody that normally would discuss this. They're all about equality, but not the same type. The second part is completely women-centric, and that rubs some people the wrong way in another aspect, meaning that women actually have more rights than men at this point. There's a lot that they get away with that we don't, and they get a free pass for a lot of different behaviors. On the flip side, men do a lot of really nasty things when it comes down to it. I was in a Twitter discussion. It was last week. And lost a couple followers from it because it was right during the Women's March. But no skin off my back because they were arguing points that could not be defended. And one of them finally admitted that he could not defend it. Even though he continued to argue and just insult me, which was kind of the same thing I expect from a Christian, to be honest. Because next thing you hear after they can't defend their post is, you're going to hell and you're going to burn forever and all that other kind of just garbage. But let me get over to the crux of the issue here. So we're talking about just the definition, the theory, political, economic, and social equality of the sexes. I wanted to break this part down first before I move forward, and there's some method to my madness here. So the reason I wanted to break it down is because the difference between the way non-feminists and feminists view this is all centered in the definition. And to a point, this one is not clear, but that's because people's visions of equality differ. So for the more rational people, the ones that follow evolutionary biology, evolutionary psychology, in particular, understand that there is sexual dimorphism, that men and women are in fact different and not equal in every single way, that there are evolutionary history between us and the rest of the planet. In other words, we're apes, and apes are primarily a patriarchal society. You won't see a matriarch in an ape family, at least not that I'm aware. If you went to whales and elephants and those bigger mammals, they're actually a matriarchy. So if we were more genetically close to those animals, chances are women would be leading and not men. But alas, we are apes nonetheless, and that part of us doesn't go away just because we become higher thinking or forward thinking. And one of the contentions I covered on an earlier episode is that feminism has decided to create an alternative to evolutionary psychology because they didn't like the answers that they were getting out of evolutionary psychology. It was sexist to say that we are similar to apes and our behaviors are kind of the same, and it objectifies women or somewhat, so there's such business. But you can't really argue with facts, and if you do, you end up being an idolater. That's what it comes down to. So the point I wanted to make is that the definition is important because we can both start from the same place but come up with completely different answers. For example, when I say equality of the sexes, what I expect to be understood by other people that I'm discussing it with is that every person, man, woman, doesn't matter, in a Western society, let's be specific, we're talking the Women's March, for example, was in the five most equal countries on this planet, and they were the most boisterous, is that a word? They were the loudest of their constituents. And in this, equality has been achieved for the most part. In fact, the tables have been turned in some aspects. For example, in the U.S., women do not have to apply for the draft. That just to, when you turn 18 as a male, you have to enlist as for the draft. If you want to vote, if you want to do anything, driver's license, you have to register for the draft. And the draft is a government mandate that says, if we go to a major world war, you're going to war. In fact, I think the last time it was used was in Vietnam, where men and women were drafted to go to fight. In actuality, it was just the men that went to fight. Women didn't have to. That's an inequality. If they wanted to go fight so bad and they wanted true equality, they should also register for the draft. You won't see them doing it because they have aversion to violence. They are more nurturing rather than aggressive. That's another evolutionary psychology thing. And of course, in this little aspect, they're all aligned with the evolutionary psychology because men are more aggressive. So, of course, they're going to agree with it. Of course, they don't want to go to war because it's actually in their nature. So they'll find ways to fit that into their narrative, which is fine so long as they recognize that hypocrisy. But of course, they don't. So it's kind of a moot point. So when I say equality, I'm talking equality of opportunity. So in all the countries in the Western world, equality of opportunity is a thing. It exists. We wouldn't have a man and a woman running for both president of the United States. We wouldn't have Merkel as prime minister, I believe, of Germany. We wouldn't have many other women leaders if they didn't have equal opportunity. It just, they would be shut down. It wouldn't happen. If the patriarchy existed in a Western society, they would have no opportunity to go and be a leader. Just wouldn't happen. You wouldn't see them in CEOs. You wouldn't see them in management positions. They would be put in a lesser role. I can only think of other countries that are not Western that do this. And we'll get to them in a little bit, and some of the issues there. So as you can see, equality has been achieved for the most part in Western society. And you'll see some of the main arguments, like the pay gap and stuff like that. Of course, these can be summed up in evolutionary psychology as a matter of choice. Women choose lower paying jobs, not that they want to choose to get paid lower. This is another twisting of definitions and meanings. But they choose the jobs that pay less because it's more in their interest. For example, psychology, sociology, and medicine are the highest chosen fields for women over men. Like, men do not choose these fields for the most part, women do. In so much, medicine, psychology, sociology, they don't get paid as much as technology, STEM, and more analytical or building things. Not to say that women do not choose these roles. If they're interested, they certainly can. But the fact of the matter is, they're not as interested as a man is, for whatever reason. Men like to build things. Women like to keep social people together. That is just a behavior trait that's always existed in our species. So, women and equality, when we get back to the definition, they have this. They can choose whatever they want to choose. There are some things where they don't get to choose at this point. Your gender, for example. They like to preach that it's a social construct. There are multiple disorders, genetic disorders, that kind of puts you in a gray area of absolutely male or absolutely female. The fact of the matter is, you cannot be male without the Y chromosome. So you're pretty much, you know, there's a delineating line there. As far as genetics go. And we've noticed that these, in particular, disorders come with some heavy baggage, such as taller, infertile, mentally retarded, handicapped, you name it. There's some debilitating factors that come with these genetic deformities, is essentially what they are. And beyond that, the two genders, male and female, are subjected to a wide array of feminist rhetoric because it doesn't fit with their vision. And their vision is social equality. Now, to get it on to the feminist side, for those that kind of don't understand, maybe you're on the fence, maybe you are a feminist, you'll probably agree with this one, that if a man and a woman are working the same job, they should get paid the same. That seems fair and rational. Let's put it into perspective. As it's put, women tend to take more time off than men because they assume the roles of family care and child care, even though men can do it too. For some reason, depending on the family, women tend to do it more than men. So they take more time off. There's also the maternity leave, where you take a couple months off and only partially paid for that. In some countries, you actually get a full year off. Like I heard in Australia, you get a full year off. That's pretty impressive. And I think it's more than justified because it takes at least a year for them to be able to be accepted into daycare so they can go back to work. Mainly because, you know, you got potty churning and all that fun crazy stuff that's always, you know, even in that, boys are easier to teach to potty train than women, ironically, because you only have to teach a kid to aim. I know this from having three boys and a girl. The girl was the more challenging. Even my niece is more challenging. It's entertaining. So when we get down to it, we're talking about a difference in vision, and the delineating line between anti-feminist and feminist is anti-feminists, those that I think are on the rational side, which would seem to be the more accurate statement, is the people on the side of rationality see equality of opportunity, but it is impossible to achieve equality of outcome with being fair. So two people working the same job, but one works less than the other because of choice and individual preference, while the men tend to work harder, or not harder, but work more, I should say. You do not deserve to be paid the same. One's there all the time, one's there, one's not. Do you both deserve a raise? It depends on job performance. If you're taking time off for whatever reason, while the other one's there and hasn't missed a single day, even when sick. Equality of outcome is unfair to both sides, because it can happen both ways. For example, a guy could be taking a whole bunch of time off, but the woman is there every single day. Doesn't miss a day. Doesn't bring her kids to work either. Maybe she's single. Let's go with single. But the guy, he's like drunk. I don't know. Like goes partying a lot. I don't know. For whatever reason, he doesn't show up to work as much as the woman. Well, the woman should get paid more than the man at that point. Does that always happen? I don't know. In my experience, it does turn out that way, that the woman gets paid more than the man. It all depends on their preference. Speaking of which, what you'll often hear as an argument is that they, in the vision of equality of outcome, that versus the equality of opportunity, that the pay gap and the 78 cents to the dollar is a real huge issue. If you look at the numbers, and the reason why this has been debunked 100 times over, is once personal choice is calculated, or if they calculate same job, same earning, same starting time, the equality starts out. It's the choices the person makes on either side of the fence that determines whether or not they get promoted, whether or not they make more money or not. And negating this personal choice, what feminists expect is equality of outcome regardless of personal choice. That's not equality, that's privilege. So there's an issue there. So moving on, if you understand the difference between the two, that one seeks equality of outcome while the other that's anti-feminist is equality of opportunity, there's some huge problems with the other social movements if that's what they demand. So connecting feminism to the other social movements doesn't take a big leap to look. So if we look at the about page for Black Lives Matter, if you go and start the first blurb, Black Lives Matter was created in 2012 for Trayvon Martin's murder. George Zimmerman was acquitted. 17-year-old Trayvon was placed on trial for his own murder. And they try to paint this kid as a problem, even though he assaulted somebody and was trying to take the kid's gun, from what I read. The autopsy report does not agree with their narrative, in other words. So you skip past, you know, if you start at the top of the screen and do not scroll anywhere, this is all you can read. And then you see a Black Lives Matter motif at the bottom. But if you scroll down just a bit, you can read some more. And this is where I say that it starts to connect to feminism, because feminism is all about women, right? So keep that in mind as we look at the second definition, where we go organized activity on behalf of women's rights and interests. So this is women-centric and has nothing to do with equality to men, but equality over men. So if we go into the second paragraph, it goes beyond the narrow nationalism that can be prevalent within Black communities, which merely call on Black people to love Black people, live Black and by Black, keeping straight cis Black men in at the front of the movement, while our sisters, queer and trans, and disabled folk take roles up in the background or not at all. So there you go. It's calling out for straight Black men, and they're part of the issue. That is an indicator that this movement is not for equality, but for superiority over males, specifically Black males. Black Lives Matter affirms the lives of Black, queer, and trans folks, disabled folks, Black undocumented folks, folks with records, women, and all black lives under the gender spectrum. It centers on those that have been marginalized in black liberation movements as it is a tactic to rebuild the black liberation movement. So there's another call. Along the gender spectrum really focuses on this illusion that was made up by feminists that negates evolutionary psychology and biology, ironically, that there is a spectrum, spectrum of genders. There's only two. There's two sexes, male and female. Gender expression can change. However, it's either male to female or female to male. It's never some bizarre thing in between. If you're thinking that you're a wolf or a sheep or a dog, there's mental health facilities can help you with that because it's not a normal thing. And to try and claim that another species is a gender is a misnomer because you're now pretending to be another species other than human, not another sex, but another species. There's an issue with that, and it's a delusional. So as you read into Black Lives Matter, we can see the connection, because they're one of the biggest movements that are out there right now, that is specific to race, because all they care about is the black person. But they're also woman-centric, meaning that the only thing they care about is females and trans females. So this is the man gone to a woman. They praise that. Not that there's anything wrong with it. If you look at Blair White, my wife can't tell that used to be a dude. I showed my sister, however, and she's like, yeah, that's a guy. Could tell right off the bat. That's because me and my sister used to hang around clubs and that where we know quite a few trannies in where we grew up. So that connects to one. So you can see where there's a connection there where they care about women's issues, but specific to their own race. So specific to black people. And they lump another bunch of people in there, queer, trans, disabled. But they only call out for the females. You also note that the leaders, the founders of Black Lives Matter, are, in fact, feminists themselves. If you listen to a couple of their talks and commentaries, you'll hear they take the feminist talking points and spin it just ever so slightly to mean they're talking about their particular race. So let's get over to why I find this the issue. So the reason why I bring up Black Lives Matter is at the end of their meetings, they have a phrase. And I forgot to search it up, so I apologize for let me see if I can find on the, maybe their page. But they have a, there we go. Maybe this will be a better Goodreads. Quoted by Asasa Secure. And She's one of the motivators for the Black Lives Matter movement. Asada Shakur. I hope I said that right. And you'll find that this quote, they'll say at the end of like every single one of their meetings. And here's where you can connect the feminist rhetoric, Black Lives Matter, and its manifestation of feminism, because it's slightly different than the rest of the mainstream feminists. And something else is quite interesting. So I'm going to do a side-by-side comparison to this and a book I picked up that was free on Amazon. And let me pull up that right now. I need to log into my laptop here. Okay, so let me quote Asada Shakur first. It is a duty to fight for our freedom. It is a duty to win. We must love each other and support each other. We have nothing to lose but our chains. This is said at the end of every Black Lives Matter meeting, You'll hear the affectionately called Black Hitler say this shit. And there's reasons why I have issue with this. It sounds noble on the surface. You would think these words here are indicative of somebody that's being oppressed. And if you believe you're oppressed in this society, then yes, it would make sense to do that. They're not, other than their own culture is oppressing themselves, which is self-destructive to say the least. When you praise the thug, you praise the criminal, and you don't praise the ones that have been successful, like Obama, like many of our senators that are Black, like many of the CEOs, CIOs, COOs, and other executive leadership that have been successful. Morgan Freeman is another example. These people don't buy into this. And this is why. It connects directly to a thought process that's exactly the end. It's at the end, antithetical to American life or Western culture. It is the it is self-destructive. It is very. It goes against the representative republic and the free society that we have. They seek to do and act upon anybody that dissents from them in an opinion. Hence why it is duty to fight for their freedom. When you speak out against them and disagree, well, you are oppressing them because they said so, not because you disagree. So there's a little blurb at the end of this book here, and I'll tell you what the name of the book is in a moment. But let me read like the last two, three paragraphs. In short, these everywhere support every revolutionary moment against the existing social and political order of things. In all these movements, they bring to the front as a leading question in each the property question. No matter what its degree of development at the time. Finally, they labor everywhere for the union and agreement of democratic parties of all countries. They disdain to conceal their views and aims. They openly declare the ends can be only attained by forcibly overthrowing all existing social conditions. They have a duty to fight for their freedom. Let the ruling classes tremble at the revolution. They have nothing to lose but their chains. They have the world to win. The last two sentences, listen to this. I'm cutting words out on purpose, by the way. There's more to it, but I'm cutting specific words out so that it doesn't give it away. They have nothing to lose but their chains. They have the world to win. These are the last two lines. We have nothing to lose but our chains. The last line of their chant. It is our duty to win. Changing just a little bit. They have the world to win. It is their duty to win. Not much difference there. It's their duty to win at their war, their revolution. Where it differs, we must love each other and support each other. It's a unity clause. There's a little bit of that in this book as well. Not specifically that statement there, but it's pretty close. And it is their duty to fight for their freedom. In this book as well, it says that it's the duty of these people to fight anywhere for their rights to put down their opposition. It's important for them to fight. This book that I'm referring to, that has direct quotes out of it, that's the core of the Black Lives Matter movement, is the Communist Manifesto. For those that are familiar with it, it's written by Frederick Ingalls. And it was written a long time ago, like 100 years ago. Well, not 100 years ago. It's really close. But it was written and formed the Communist Party, the Communist Movement, Communist Russia, Communist China. These groups are the paramount of feminism. Feminists don't necessarily come out and say these particular words. It seems to be more heavily associated with the Black Lives Matter movement than I've heard in feminists. Feminists tend to argue with other tools. But this enchant is really telling. And it also points out that the feminist movement now has become a Marxist ideology. If we connect the two, feminists have the same ideological thinking as the Black Lives Matter movement. Black Lives Matter only cares about the females, does not care about the males. And then you connect the feminists in general and listen to what they have said. Because they're all about defending what the Communist Manifesto called the proletariat against the bourgeoisie. In this case, you replace these two words with protect the minority against the cis white male or the patriarchy, however you want to put it. And you see a connection. So what this also connects to, and a lot of people have already bought the book and it's a little bit disturbing, is the idea that this is an Orwellian thought. You'll see it called out in a lot of different YouTube videos, different podcasts. And I wanted to go over a little bit what that means. And to be honest, I have not yet read 1984. It's on my bookshelf behind me. It's in my reading list. I got another book that I'm reading right now before I go on to this one. But to give you the definition of, pertaining to, characteristics of, or resembling the literary work of George Orwell, or the totalitarian future described as in his anti-utopian novel, 1984. That was a lot of words. So it's a totalitarian future. So what feminists are trying to look for is a socialist collective. So it's not necessarily Orwellian or totalitarian, although people have emerged as leaders in these groups and have demanded certain things as a social group and get everybody in the group that believes in the same stuff to act as a mob. And this is where it connects to social justice. So just like a religion, people adhere to things in the religion blindly. Take the Christians, for example. They believe that most atheists are going to hell. We hear it all the time. The Burritos, for disagreeing with them, saying Jesus isn't real, didn't ever existed, there's no evidence for God, that type of stuff. And the vicious attacks come out in droves. You'll see troll after troll after troll attacking us. There have been movies made about how horrible we are. Ray Comfort, the Banana Man, for example, is a perfect example of he's tried to shut down channels with DMCA strikes, with his rhetoric. So it's not uncommon for people when they have attached themselves to an ideology, to a belief, that they internalize it, they make it a part of their core values. And equality is a value that most people can adhere to and think it's a very good thing, and then they associate it in the way that feminists do, which is equality of outcome rather than equality of opportunity. And it becomes a ideological thinking because they think that nothing is equal. And it really drives home. So what happens in social justice, and the reason why this is such an issue, and no one seems to have pointed it out yet, so hopefully this will be new to you and I'm pointing it out here, that social justice is a perversion of actual justice. Let me repeat that. Social justice is a perversion of actual justice. Why would I say that? Well, in my view, and in, it is my opinion based on the definitions of social and justice, when you combine these two things. Justice is blind. If we were to go and look up, since I'm on dictionary.com, I might as well do it now, and we look up justice. The quality of being just, righteousness, equitableness, or moral righteousness, rightfulness and or lawfulness as a claim of title, just or grounds, justness of ground or reason. The moral principle of determining conduct, there's a whole bunch of different definitions. The one that I'm going to focus on here is number 7, judgment of persons or causes by judicial process. Administering, deserving punishment or reward, maintaining administration of what is by laws, judicial is our meetings. Conformity to this principle as manifested in conduct, just conduct or dealing or treatment, moral principle, you know. So essentially, if you read these, what they're talking about is all things equal, all things treated the same. That seems fair. The piece I wanted to pull out of here is justness of ground or reason. So if you were to reason out, that's, you should believe the victim before you should believe the accused. Or if you were a reasonable person and you wanted to reason your way out, you would believe neither and look for objective evidence that would substantiate either claim. I didn't do it, or I did do it. In this case, what you see is that the just looks for equality of they try to make the equality of outcome in this particular set. And, There's a problem here, because in social justice, if you look up the word social, relating to or devoted to, characterized by friendly companionship or relations, seeking the enjoyment and companionship of others. So it's all about connecting people involved in many social activities of or relating to human society, especially in the bodies divided into classes according to status, so social rank, right? Living or disposed in living companionship with others in a community rather than in isolation. So this grouping is what social is about. You're talking about grouping people together. This sounds normal, and it is, because we are a social species. We tend to flock together in groups that are like-minded individuals. That's why not everybody sticks to the same job with the same company, that type of thing. When you mash these two together, it is mob rule. It is not reason that brings forth the accused to justice. It is the mob that decides on who to believe and bring to justice. In particular, social justice folks that I've heard said you should always believe the victim. Always. And this is particularly, they call it out when it's focused on rape, for example. Yet there have been many, many rape cases where the woman has lied. And there have been many rape cases where the man has lied. Interestingly enough, there's also been cases where the man was raped and the woman had lied. There was one just recently that I read about where a woman got a man expelled from college because she slept with him and didn't want to face her friend. So she lied about it and said he raped her. Come to find out that he was blackout drunk. And not only that, she slept with somebody else the same night that she called over. Was that rape too? Because I'm pretty sure he was probably passed out in the other room while she did it. Sounds like a college party. So social justice is a perversion of actual justice because it removes the ability to reason. It's now mob rule. It's now socialized justice. The last time we had something like that was the Salem witch trials, where people decided whether or not you're a witch, not based on evidence. If we look at Monty Python, you will see they weighed a goose against a lady with an uneven scale to determine whether or not she was a witch. That type of reasoning is the same type of reasoning that's being used today. You don't believe the victim. You don't believe the accused. You look at the evidence and determine who was right and who was wrong. That is the reasonable person to do, because evidence is objective. It does not care who's right or wrong. And that goes for every crime. So when you see the outrage of these people on social media, on the mainstream media that call out the unarmed black man every time somebody gets hurt or shot or whatnot, he's unarmed. Unarmed does not mean non-lethal. Unarmed does not mean not aggressive. That's the biggest problem. So the connection to social justice in this thing to feminism is because it's pushed forth a narrative to look at things with a different vision. So when you take justice, which is meant to be reasonable, which is meant to look at the objective truth, and conflate it with social truth, where people decide how they want to look at a sideways angle and believe the victim or believe the accused without reason. You just assume. That is another part of the feminist movement. They have made things up, literally. Not figuratively, but literally. There is now echo chambers in academic society pushing forth feminist rhetoric with zero basis in reality or facts. They've already established their theory, so they make up studies to try and push forth this theory, just like the creationists did with intelligent design, trying to argue that that's an alternative to evolution. It's the same thing. There was a recent article, I shouldn't say recent, it was a few years ago, that was in Psychology Today, where they wrote about this very thing, talking about evolutionary psychology has made a number of these things fact. We compare it to our other species. We watch the behaviors of other people and find that this is an accurate depiction based on our evolutionary psychology and our biology. They literally said, this is not a perfect quote, but it's pretty dang close, we need an alternative theory. I've heard them say words before when somebody was talking about intelligent design, that evolution is not definitive science and we need an alternative theory. Let's discuss, how did George Bush put it? Let's discuss the issue. Let's debate the issue. Let's debate the alternatives. Expose the alternatives. How did he put it? I can't remember specifically, but it was definitely a creationist claptrap crap. So let's move on to why I decided to cover this in particular. And that's the Women's March. And I'm going to connect this to another piece that I started out with at the beginning of this show. And why I think this is going to be very self-destructive for them as it continues forward. So, right off the Women's March website, I'm going to go with their mission statement. They got a mission here and a vision. So they got a mission and vision. We stand together in solidarity with our partners and children for the protection of our rights, our safety, our health, and our families, recognizing that our vibrant and diverse communities are the strength of our country. I actually do agree with that statement and vision and mission. The way they're going about it is not the same vision that I would have. They're arguing for division of the families, welfare state, men are not needed. In fact, if you're a white male in their culture, you are the epitome of the devil. You're just evil. You're straight up useless. And even having the conversation makes you moot. You can't talk about feminism. That's the first rule. And the second rule is you cannot talk about feminism. Yeah. So let's get on to the mission. The rhetoric of the past election cycle has insulted, demonized, and threatened many of us immigrants of all statuses, Muslims and those of diverse religious faiths, and people who identify as an alphabet, native people, black, brown people, people with disabilities, survivors of sexual assault, and our communities are hurting and scared. We are confronted with the question of how to move forward in face of a national and international concern and fear. So that's just the first thing. Let me continue on just to be fair, so I'm not cherry picking or somebody can blame me for being out of context. In the spirit of democracy and honoring the champions of human rights, dignity, and justice who have come before us, we join in diversity and show our presence in numbers too great to ignore. The Women's March on Washington will send a bold message to our new government on the first day of office and to the world that women's rights are human rights. We stand together recognizing that defending most of the marginalized among us is defending us all. We support the advocacy of resistance movements that reflect our multiple and intersectioning identities. We call on all defenders of human rights to join us. This march is the first step towards unifying our communities, grounded in new relationships to create change from the grassroots level up. We will not rest until women have parity and equity in all levels of leadership in society. We will work peacefully while recognizing there is no true peace without justice and equity for all. So, here's the problems. Their definition of equality is equality of outcome. As you can read just right there, I'll start from the ground up, that they expect parity and equity in all levels of leadership. If a woman's not interested in leading, you shouldn't have to force them to lead. If they choose not to, don't force it upon them. They'll just be miserable. Now, if you want to lead and you want to run these marches, then why don't you run for government? Why aren't you running for office? In fact, I believe a few of those people that were in the Women's March movement were, in fact, senators that lost their position to Republicans this year. Right? Where I stand on the political spectrum, I'm now leaning toward a libertarian point of view. I've been Democrat for such a long time. But the Democrats are they're lost. There's a new Liberty Democrats, I think is what they're calling themselves. Kyle Kalinske talked about it. I'm thinking about looking into joining them. I have to discuss it with my wife first to see if it's something the family wants to put themselves through. But this is a significant thing because there was millions of people out. This demonstrates that how many people believe feminism. It is the new religion. They have moved past being a cult. 5 million plus people all out to march in favor of feminism is now in leagues with some of the larger religions there are out there. And it's all based on alternative facts, alternative theories, alternative facts. That's probably a bad term to use considering Trump used it like a moron. It's not alternative facts. It's based on lies, based on half-truths, where they've taken pieces of information and spun it to their narrative. It's self-destructing as well. And this connects to the last bit that I wanted to talk about. So you saw in there, as they're talking about gay, lesbian, native people, black, brown, people with disabilities, survivors of sexual assault, and so on and so forth. Right at the top there, and it just irritates the living hell out of me. Threatened by many of us, immigrants of all statuses. Well, illegal immigrants cut in line. There are some that have come across. They were legal, their visas expired, what have you. Those people have been slighted probably by the system because they were applying for citizenship, they were working toward a work visa, a school visa, or what have you, and they couldn't maintain their citizenship or their visa for that matter. I know a few friends of mine that are in that boat, and they have to go back to their country now, not under Trump's rule, but this is under Obama's administration as well. They had to go back to the country just to get citizenship and a visa to come back here. And that could take a year or two. They've been trying to work through a lawyer to get this all handled, and it's just been stupid. So there are some legit scoffs there. But the next piece is what I want to focus on. Muslims and those of diverse religious faiths. In the Bible, women are second-class citizens. Period. There is a verse, and in fact, I should have pulled this up for you. And I apologize. I am lazy. But I'll look it up right now. Ezekiel. I think this is the right one. No, that's not it. Let's see if I can find the thing here. So there's a passage in the Bible. I'm trying to find it for you. Let's see here. So there's parts in Ephesians that say, you know, they're equality, their women are a part of it. But not quite, because it says right there, wives, understand and support your husbands in the ways that show support for Christ. The husband provides leadership to his wife the way Christ does to his church, not by domineering, but by cherishing. So it says to love your wife, right? Basically. But it also says that men are leaders. That means women are not leaders. There's leaders and followers. There's not two leaders. Not in their world, anyways. But here's the kicker right here. Ready? Just as the church submits to Christ as he exercises such leadership, wives should likewise submit to their husbands. Yeah. So, yeah, let's support that diverse religious faith, right? Because if we lived in a true Christian society, women would be subservient to men. And there's sections in there that say that women cannot teach. They're not allowed to speak to a man, and do not pretend you can teach to us because you know nothing. Now, in the Quran, it's much worse. They had a picture out there, and I'm pretty sure most people saw it, about women wearing hijab with that was the American flag, essentially. The reason it's not the American flag bit that I have a problem with. The problem I have with this thing is the sheer stupidity that they think the hijab recommends and suggests women's equality. In the Quran, it tells you that women should cover up because they're a precious jewel that needs to be covered up and shielded from men, because men are just desirables. And I can see where the feminists love this rhetoric, because they like to paint men as rapists. Like, I can't tell you how many times I've been accused of supporting rape, being a rapist myself, or being a rape apologist. In fact, probably Steve Shives, if he ever saw this, would say I'm a rape apologist, even though he's a complete dipshit for supporting and defending the Muslim faith when he's an atheist and they want his head. I can't believe that he's so naive to think that Muslims are so great. If we look at the violence in comparison to other religions, and as much as they like to point out the Crusades, the Ottoman Empire came first, and just see how much savagery came out of that. But I digress. This point that I'm trying to make is they're defending Muslims and those of diverse religious faiths. Muslims segregate their wives from the men because the women are not allowed to worship inside the same church annexed to their men. And the imams do not need to speak to them. And a woman doesn't necessarily have to, you know, the women are not allowed to speak to the men in such a manner that's disrespectful. You're not allowed to have a divorce under Sharia unless the man says, I divorce you. Meaning it's the man's choice, the woman. It's the epitome. Both religions, you want to respect as a women's march, the equality of women, the antithesis, the paramount idea of equality, and you're falling back and defending the religions that enslaved you in the first place. I find that just incredibly stupid and appalling. It doesn't make sense to me. The whole reason the women's march is an idiotic demonstration of the power of feminism is because when feminism started and founded, that wouldn't have happened. Women were subservient to men. In all of the Muslim countries, none marched with the women's march. Because if they did, they'd be dead. If you don't believe me, see the last flogging and burning of a Muslim woman because she disagreed with her husband in Germany. Not even in the Middle East. This happened in Germany. The man was pissed off. It was a little pod of Muslims, immigrants. She was set on fire in the middle of the street. That's appalling. And you want to talk about defending this belief system? We're talking about the actions of believers because they carry things out based on their ideology. Just like the feminists have. They believe everything's unequal, so they try to impose laws that force equality of outcome. For example, there was a part I wrote, and I believe I put it in my podcast, talking about the equality of outcome when it comes to the mandated, what did they call it? It was gender quotas in leadership positions. These gender quotas are essentially a demand that all businesses have an equal amount of men and women leadership on all boards. Meaning that if there's women leaders, they got to be on the board. And it needs, if there's like 9-person boards, they can have a split decision. 5 of those have to be women, not 4. They got to be the majority and not the minority. Ironically, the same study I read this about, they did it on 5 different countries. 2 of them had failing businesses. 1 of them didn't matter because it was already gender neutral, so they were pretty much there. 1 of them just barely put it in place, so they didn't have enough data to pull from it. And the last one was the beacon of shining happiness. So, and they had nothing but success in the gender quotas because the population was already feminist, as it were. It was Italy, I believe. And they praised Italy, but they shot down the rest because bigotry. That was their excuse. No evidence whatsoever. Nothing that they could point out and say that this was true. Just a claim. And this is what happens. So they take the data they like and throw the rest of it out because they have feelings. So that's the end of my show here. I'll continue on. I have a piece for the after show. Where should we focus and why should we focus at this issue? Because there are actual issues in women's rights that need to have attention. And we're not giving it their proper attention. Unfortunately, they're more worried about a fictitious number of outcome rather than the bigger issues. So thank you for joining me. I'm sorry that I took a month off. It was I got sick. So you really didn't want to listen to that. And Christmas, of course, and a whole bunch of holidays. And I have birthdays in December that I had to deal with. So thank you all. And I'll see you next time.